I'm no big Hollywood producer or writer, but I imagine crafting a sequel to a successful film must be a pretty difficult process. You could end up being too similar to the original formula, and you'll be labeled as unoriginal or just a cash-in imitation. But drift too far from that formula, and you'll be criticized for being too different. I imagine this process must be even harder for a comedy sequel, as you risk either falling back on older jokes and gags you did, or drifting too far away from what people liked in the original, and they just won't find it funny at all. I imagine some of these thoughts and questions might have been going through the minds of Chris Matheson and Ed Solomon when they were tasked with writing a sequel to the 1989 science fiction comedy Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, which they also wrote. The original Bill and Ted had a somewhat simple enough premise. Two slackers, Bill S. Preston Esquire and Ted Theodore Logan, brilliantly played by Alex Winter and Keanu Reeves, are on the verge of flunking history, with Ted being sent to military school if this happens, thus threatening to break up their band Wild Stallions. A man from the future named Rufus, played by George Carlin, travels back in time to give them a time machine to help them with their report that will make or break their grade. You see, in the future, Bill and Ted's band manages to usher in an era of world peace and enlightenment through their music. And so our two lovable slackers must embark on a quest to gather historical figures and bring them to the present to pass their presentation. Along the way, there are many hijinks and jokes about the historical figures interacting with the society of 1989, such as Genghis Khan raiding a sporting goods store, Joan of Arc taking over an aerobics class, and Napoleon going to a water park named Waterloo. Pretty simple, right? It's a pretty out there premise, but it really works thanks to all the historical figure jokes being really well done and honestly pretty clever. And perhaps most of all, thanks to how likable Bill and Ted are. They have this fun, happy-go-lucky attitude. You just want to root for them. Another good bit of humor is how they play with the rules of time travel, like being able to find conveniently placed items because, oh, we'll just put them there when we're all done with this.
After the report, we'll time travel back to 2 days ago, steal your dad's keys, and leave them here. That way, when we get here now, they'll be waiting for us. See?
Whoa, yeah!
There is probably a paradox there waiting to happen or something, but it sure makes for some really funny scenes. So the question is, now where do you take these characters and storyline? Now that you already did something as grand and hilarious as going to the past and the future. Well, I guess really the only place they could go after going back and forth in time is up, down, and all around, and any and all places in between. After such an excellent adventure, I suppose they could only follow this up with a bogus journey. The film starts in the far-off, oddly specific year of 2691, where we have the Utopian Society created by the music of Wild Stallions. At least they gave themselves a few centuries for this to be relevant, so it's not a Blade Runner or Destroy All Monsters scenario. Rufus is teaching a class at Bill and Ted University when an evil terrorist and former gym teacher, Chuck D'Anomalo, strikes, stealing the time machine phone booth and sending evil robotic counterparts of our lovable leads to wreak havoc in the past to destroy the future. Rufus tries to stop them but seemingly becomes lost in the circuits of time. In the present time, Bill and Ted are now living with the princesses they met in the last film and are poised to enter the San Dimas Battle of the Bands televised event. The one problem is that the duo are still pretty terrible at their instruments, but the organizer of the event, played by Pam Grier, gives them a chance as the closing act. Later that evening, Bill and Ted propose to the princesses with the promise of marriage as soon as they reach success. Not long after, the evil robots arrive from the future and meet up with our duo, telling them that they are themselves from the future and that they must follow them in order to save the future. When the robots take them to Vasquez Rock, they reveal their true purpose and force them onto a cliff. The evil duo then force Bill and Ted off the cliff as they plummet to their deaths. Yes, you heard that right, our two lovable, endearing protagonists are killed off by their evil robot counterparts. I would argue this marks a sort of turning point in the film. Things are already a bit out there, so to speak. But this is where Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey becomes an absolutely bonkers tale of epic proportions. So Bill and Ted are dead, and now their souls rise from their bodies, and they are greeted by the Grim Reaper. He tells our duo that he will bring them to hell with him unless they can best him in a contest, a feat that no one has ever accomplished. So what are our two protagonists to do when they are met with such a challenge?
Excuse us, dude, but your shoes are untied.
Oh.
After our duo Melvin their way out of a brush with death himself, they make their way to their home to find their evil doppelgangers are in the process of ruining their relationships with the princesses, and are dead set on destroying the rest of their lives while assuming their identity. Bill and Ted try to figure out how to stop the robots in their new state, such as possessing Ted's father. I mean, hey, it worked in The Exorcist, 1 and 3.
I totally possessed my dad!
Eventually, they make it to a seance at Ted's house, held by a stepmom, and Bill's former stepmom, Missy. They try to warn her of the danger posed by their mechanical clones, but are instead cast down into hell where they are met with Satan himself. Bill and Ted react to this pretty much as you'd expect.
How's it going, Beelzebub? Okay, can we go now?
Satan then sends the duo down to meet their own personal fears. The segment in hell is definitely the most visually striking segment of the film, maybe of any comedy that I can think of. There's a great usage of camera angles and color to really accentuate the really exaggerated, surreal nature of Bill and Ted's own personal hell and their fears. We begin with Bill and Ted encountering Colonel Oates, a head of a military school Ted's father wanted to send him to an excellent adventure, who is finally shown earlier in Bogus' journey, with the pair escaping only to find their own separate versions of the fears they face as children. Bill encounters a family gathering where he sees his creepy-looking grandmother, while Ted encounters an evil Easter Bunny who scolds him for taking his little brother's candy. When their fear reaches its breaking point, Bill and Ted are forced to take the Reaper's earlier offer and partake in a game with death. What grueling challenge awaits our lovable heroes in this new realm of the underworld? Well, Battleship. The duo chooses modern games to challenge the Grim Reaper, such as the aforementioned Battleship, Clue, Electric Football, and Twister. But we find that not only is the Grim Reaper pretty bad at them, but he's also a very, very sore loser.
Best of seven?
Damn right!
Finally relenting, the Grim Reaper admits defeat to our duo, and as part of the deal, he will help them on their journey. They ask Death to take them to find a super genius who can help them defeat their evil robot doppelgangers when they head back to the world, which takes them to, where else, heaven. Bill and Ted eventually meet God, yes, you heard that right, and they tell him of their problem and that they need his help. God then provides them with a map that will help them in their journey and bring them to the geniuses that they seek.
Thanks, God.
Yeah, you are just a noble creator.
God's directions lead them to a pair of short aliens named Station. Station agrees to help Bill and Ted as they are all transported back to the mortal world. Bill, Ted, Death, and Station go to a hardware store where they get supplies to build two good robot versions of Bill and Ted. The Station duo combines to form one massive lifeform who builds the robots on their way to the Battle of the Bands. The scene is set for an epic showdown. Will Bill and Ted triumph over Denomalous and the evil robots? Will they save the babes? Will they win the Battle of the Bands? I mean, there's a sequel coming out this year, so that should be able to tell you a few things. The best way I could describe Bogus Journey's plot is that it feels like a large majority of it was improvised in the writing process. Like, every part of it was made to sort of one-up the last crazy thing that happened. Like, Bill and Ted die, but it's okay. They meet the Grim Reaper, but they give him a wedgie. They meet the Devil, and then comes a parody of the Seventh Seal. Then they meet God. It's just so insane, and I don't mean this in a negative way whatsoever. It really makes it feel like a wild, crazy ride, and I love it. I'm sure the actual writing process wasn't like this, but I'm pretty happy the end result kind of feels like it was. In so many ways, this feels like a major departure from the first film, but that feels somewhat fitting. The only way I think you can really make a fitting sequel to a movie about going back in time to pass a history report is to just go all the way with these ideas established in the universe and see how far you can take it. Time travel? Yeah, that's one thing, but what about concepts like heaven and hell, the Grim Reaper, and the spirit realm? I feel like they could have gone the easy way and make a story like Bill and Ted have to stop a bad guy who's screwing up time, so they have to visit parts of the past to fix it, or something like that. I mentioned before how Excellent Adventure establishes a sort of time travel that plays really well for comedic effect. The whole we can get something now, just remember to put it there later. This is brought up again, and it's even funnier this time around.
I too can play the time game. Once I've vanquished you, I will go back and set up this key. And another gun.
You're right, dude.
Only there's one thing you didn't think of. Yeah, only the winners are gonna be able to go back and set things up, yeah.
Like I said, this probably would result in some major paradox, but who cares, it's really funny. Like I mentioned before, the segment in Hell where Bill and Ted face their own deep-seated fears is a really visually striking aspect of the movie. Director Pete Hewitt and his crew do a really good job of making use of cinematography and color to make these scenes really stand out and really feel like we're in some sort of twisted realm. For a movie essentially about two lovable slackers, it has a lot of really interesting and surreal concepts and imagery. All this really wouldn't be as entertaining without how well Alex Winter and Keanu Reeves perform as Bill and Ted. They're often not too bright, but very endearing, and you just root for them every step of the way. I think it must take a special talent to play characters who are obvious slackers, who spout out a lot of comedic dialogue, and not have them wear out their welcome or their shtick get old, especially if they're the protagonists and not just side characters. I think these two do a great job of that. For all the awesome badasses Keanu Reeves has played, his most endearing role to me will always be Ted Theodore Logan. Alex Winter seemed to switch gears at some point and swap being in front of the camera for a spot behind it, directing many films and documentaries since. William Sadler as Death himself, the Grim Reaper, is hilarious. He works great with Winter and Reeves and has a lot of great jokes. His often more solemn demeanor makes for a good contrast with the optimistic and happy-go-lucky nature of Bill and Ted. I don't know if this needs to be stated, but the soundtrack is pretty rad too. When it was released, Bogus Journey seemed to do okay business, though not as big as its predecessor. Critics and audiences seemed split on it, and it looks like that has continued to this day. I imagine the more surreal aspects of this movie may have alienated many fans of the original. A lot of it seems like the kind of stuff you wouldn't see in a teen comedy normally, like dealing with the spiritual realm, heaven and hell, and to top it all off, a segment dedicated to spoofing an Ingmar Bergman film. All these concepts are taken in a comedic light and not really meant to be taken seriously, but I imagine many felt them out of place considering the direction Excellent Adventure went with. For me, this is honestly what I love about the movie. It's such a bizarre, surreal story and experience that just runs with its ideas and pushes them as far as they can go. You're either in or out, and I was all in. I love Excellent Adventure. It's a charming, really entertaining film and one of my favorite comedies of the 80s, but for me, Bogus Journey is my favorite of the duo. I just love the outrageous ideas and concepts it introduces, and the fact that it has this "we just go with it" mentality to each and every one of them. It's so entertaining and it keeps me hooked. I love them both, but I gotta give the nod to Bogus Journey here.
Excellent!
For a long time I wondered how could you do a proper sequel to Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. I always thought the idea of a multiverse could be a cool idea to explore in a third film, one where Bill and Ted could meet and team up with alternate versions of themselves across different dimensions. I'm not sure how that would play out, but what I do know is after a long wait and many rumors, we are finally getting a third Bill and Ted movie, and I'm pretty excited. I had a few questions about some of the things that would need to be explored or answered, like why in the trailer did it look like nothing from the end of Bogus Journey seemed to happen. My guess is some evil guy altered the timeline and Bill and Ted never realized it, but I guess I'll find out for myself soon enough. I wondered why Bill and Ted now had daughters when it seemed like Little Bill and Little Ted from the end of Bogus Journey were boys. I guess those names really never registered to me as gender neutral, but I don't know, I guess Bill and Ted could work as nicknames for Wilhelmina and Theodora. I can buy that. I really do have a lot of hope for Bill and Ted Face the Music. I don't know if it will be quite as bodaciously surreal and non-heinously insane as Bogus Journey, but it doesn't have to be. And honestly, I don't think any film could ever match that level of zany excellence.